Greetings to you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, this is Mazima Kenneth once again.
And Mazima Kenneth Dakodojo.
Together with my sister Mary.
Kila Mera Mary.
Well, we want to thank the good Lord who has kept you and us alive. And we thank him so much for blessing the work of your hands that you're able to provide for your families. And some of you are also able to support the gospel. We thank the good Lord for his providence. Well, today we are discussing something that also needs to be understood in the time where we are living, and that is to do with the issue that is called what God's word says about idol worship. Now, idol worship has become a general thing in our society. Today, you hear people say, so and so is my hero, my idol, American idol. Some footballers are their idols. Some musicians are their idols. And there are several people that have been deified. They have been exalted. And they are seen as God. Some actually watch these things that are known as soap operas. That for me, if I don't watch that movie, I don't know even how I can sleep. And then the other thing is that there are a number of churches that have idols as part of their worship. And without those idols, their worship is not complete. However, my dear ones, you know the common ones. People have idols of Jesus. I hear Mary. I hear the saints. And then several others. However, when we consider the scripture, nowhere do we see that practice in the New Testament. But what we do have are many warnings about idol worship. All of you that are listening, you might say that what you're communicating, it is one of the things that does not resonate with me. I don't have. But I'm telling you, if you love your job more than you love the word of God, you also have your idol. Some of you, your husbands. Some of you, your wives. Some of you, your children. And a number of different things. Talk about cars. That even when your own kids scratch your car, you will beat him as if you don't know him. And a number of other things. Houses. And so many other physical stuff. God himself does not approve any of the type of worship towards objects that are even of himself, even if it is the Ark of the Covenant. God does not allow anything that is to do with portraying him in some sort of an idol. A number of churches today and people are seeing good where God sees no good. They have introduced a number of things that do add to what we already have in the scriptures. But looking at the book of 1 Corinthians, the apostle makes it very clear in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verses 2. He says that, know ye not that you Gentiles were carried away with dumb idols, even as you were led. That is to mean And this basically shows that to worship an idol, it is a pagan practice. Because everything that is behind an idol, it is demonic in nature. And what some people don't know, when they bow down before the idols in the courts or in the compound of their so-called churches, they don't know that they are bowing themselves down or kneeling down to a particular demon. That is why Paul talking to the Corinthians, he says, you Corinthians, that you were Gentiles. In other words, when you talk about Gentiles, those are people that never had a covenant relationship with God. They live in a way that goes beyond that which we have in the scripture. As a matter of fact, reading from the book of Exodus, if we may consider chapter 20, beginning with verses 4, the Bible says, you shall not make any graven image. The Bible says, in other words, there is a tendency on men of us wanting to craft things. There is something with us of not being fully satisfied with what has been instructed of us. So if the Bible says, you shall not make, that means it is possible for us to make. But before you conclude on that idea of wanting to make, God is what says that you shall not make for yourself an image or any likeness of anything, of anything that is in heaven, above, or on the earth, beneath, or in the water, under the earth. Now look at verses 5. It says, you shall not bow down. That is to mean, it is possible for us to bow down. But God says, please, you don't have to do that. And as I'm communicating this, there are many of you out there that are already sold out into this issue of idol worship. And some of you love your churches so much than the word of God that you're willing to offend God but choosing to please your church. It says that you shall not bow down yourself before them, nor serve them. It is a possibility for men to serve the idols, not only making them but also bowing to them, and then another thing, also serving them. So the Bible instructs us not to make them and not to bow down before them and not also to serve them. And so it doesn't say, for I, the Lord your God, I am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and the fourth generation of them that hate me. Now I want you to pay close attention to that. God forbids us from actually putting up something and then we begin to venerate it. We begin to worship it. In fact, the Hebrew word for the worship of idols is the same thing as to bow down. And actually, The book of Ezekiel has it more clear.
Book by Ezekiel tikere maling.
I want us to look at Ezekiel.
Ame wanene Ezekiel.
16:30.
Para bicher piara dia.
And this is what it says.
Ena ingo mawaju.
In Ezekiel.
Ezekiel.
16:30.
Para bicher tinga piara.
It says, "How weak is your heart?"
What in it? Twin God maromene.
Saith the Lord.
Lord mawaju.
And the Bible asking to say.
Bible metiki watch.
Seeing you do.
Neno ni utimu.
All these things.
Jeme eguniwe.
The work.
Teach.
Of imperious warish.
Bajuma kirgi party.
Woman. That is basically to me that the Israelis had gone into a deeper way of idol worship. And God calls it an abomination. The abomination is always connected to the idol worship. No matter who makes them and who worships them. There are some people who are saying, "Me, I found it as a church practice. I think the blame is not on me." But the Bible says, whoever worships, though you may not have been the idea of crafting it, you share in the same sin of him that crafted it together. And if you crafted it and you were used to craft it, but you didn't worship it, your hands were also used in a wrong way. So all of you, with the knowledge of art, and you have your workshop where you always come up with idols of different people that have lived in different history.
Well,
you might say it is my source of income, but it counterbalances everything that the scripture talks about. Let us consider the book of Leviticus, chapter 26, and then we have it more clearly. Verses chapter 26, beginning with verses 1, "You shall make you no idols." You shall make you no idols, no graven images, neither will you rear up a standing image. If you want to know what I'm telling you, go to the Church of Rome and go also to several others. They might not have a physical idol there that is already crafted in one or the other, but they might have their minister as their idol. You can never say anything to him. You can never rebuke him. You can never say something about him. Even when he is teaching error, they say, "You leave my pastor alone." So ministers to have also become some sort of idols. But the Bible says, "You shall make you no idols, no graven image, neither rear up a standing image, neither shall you set up any image of stone in your land to bow down and to eat. For I am the Lord your God." That's the same thing that is repeated in Deuteronomy 27. If we may consider verses 15, it says, "Cursed be the man that maketh any image or a molten image, an abomination unto God, the work of hands of the craftsman, and he putteth it in a secret place. And all people shall answer and say amen.
Amen.
Why would people have to say amen?
Amen.
They say amen to what God forbids.
Amen.
Not making any graven image. Some are having them at their places of work. In the mornings, the light candles, they begin to actually go through some incantations, some confessions. Money come, money come. Let them not buy from others. Let them be blinded from all other shops. Let them be blinded from all other hospitals, from all other schools, from all other radio stations, from all other TV stations. And all of that, saying and speaking things, the things which do not talk. The Bible forbids that. The Bible is very clear that we shouldn't accept such things. But one thing that the Bible stops is what the church has accepted. And that is why I've also mentioned in passing that people believe what the minister say, even when what he says contradicts the scripture. People have been fed on grass, on snails, on
petrol,
and they have been told that the Lord gave that minister a word. When people begin to idolize a minister, whatever he says goes. And some, those stupid women, they have been actually used by those ministers, and those ministers touching them in places where they're not supposed to touch them. The Bible calls it a foreign worship. Actually, when you look into the book of Judges, in chapter 2 and verse 17, the Bible still is very clear. It says, and yet they would not hearken unto their judges. The same way today, people are not hearkening to sound doctrine. I will not believe it. Yes, I have heard what you Kenyans say until my pastor says it. So they are waiting for so and so to say it, even when you yourself is saying it. You're saying it from the word of God. Even when the Bible says, you shall not hearken. So, but the Bible says, what these people did, the Israelites, in the time of the judges, is one thing that is being replayed today. The stubbornness of the Israelites is the same stubbornness that the so-called church folks are repeating. And remember, Paul the Apostle made it very clear. In 1 Corinthians 10, verse 6, that everything in the Old Testament was written for our own learning, so that we may not repeat the same things that they did that made men of them to be killed in numbers. My dear ones, if you don't know history, history has a tendency of repeating itself. People choose not to learn from history. And much of what we have in the Old Testament, God permitted it to be recorded for us in the Bible, so that you and I might learn from they that lived before us to know how we ought to live. If there are particular things that they did that were unacceptable and made them to be punished, we that have learned from their past, we shouldn't practice
Watim
the same things
that
made them
mo again
to be punished.
Kiforogini.
And I'm telling you
that wachi.
Many have not learnt that.
Ba Paul po fonyeki eon.
So I want us to understand something.
Ti ameti waniangi mo.
Every time the Bible talks about bowing down,
kare wing ma Bible lolo kum rumu pin,
it is the same statement that is related to a sexual term used of a wife giving herself to her husband. That basically means complete yielding. If we do not listen to what God says that we shouldn't practice, we are in other words completely defying from the instructions of our Heavenly Father. In other words, say we are going to go to a level that you even never thought we could actually ever get to. But my dear ones, everything that is unacceptable, if one continues to do them, it doesn't just go like that. It comes with a punishment. And we are living in a time like we started saying, not only here in the Acholi land, where people are still so very much connected to their traditions, even if many of them contradict scriptures, they will say to God that we love you, but to also hold to our traditions that contradict your word. Go to Buganda, go to Busoga with the Ambalu thing, go to Jinja and go to different places. There are several things that do have the idea of worshipping spirits, that even those that have been gotten born again, when they were belonging to a particular tribe, they still go back to the same things. But the scripture is very clear in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. The scripture made it very clear that our God is a jealous God. He has never ceased to be jealous. Loving as he is, he does not want anything that devalue him. He does not want anything that try to compete for his glory. I want to reassure you of something. Looking at our New Testament, in Acts chapter 10, the verses 26, we see something that Peter was called to minister to the house of Cornelius. But one thing that happened, in fact, if I may actually begin with verses 25, it says that as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down. At his feet and worshipped him. So the Bible says something that is very important that you need to pay close attention to. It's not what Cornelius did that we need to pay close attention to. It is how Peter responded that is very important. It says in verses 26, but Peter took him up, saying, stand up, I myself, I am also a man. The message has been communicated. No man should receive our worship. Those ones who call themselves pastors, those who call themselves bishops, apostles, presidents, ministers, if you actually bow down to them and you see them actually in the same light of how you see God. There is a danger in that. The Bible says
Cornelius
went down and worshipped him. There are so many prophets in West Africa that have received worship here in our country. You know the likes of Mbonye and so many others who do receive worship and they keep on defending themselves that it is a worthwhile thing as long as people are not forced. I'm telling you, if Peter, the foundational apostle, didn't accept that, then how about these job law Christians that were not given the same right, the same authority of the apostles to write the scripture? Who do they think they are? And I'm telling you, they are deceived, and their followers are also deceived. Because what only belongs to God cannot be shared with any man. Yeah, you might love a person indeed, but never stoop yourself too low to forget that he's a fellow man, that eats food, that drinks, that sleeps, that even goes to toilet. They are fellow men. They deserve not to be worshipped. The same thing we see in Acts 14. When Paul and Barnabas had shared the glorious gospel with people in Lystra, the Bible says, say something that Paul actually spoke by a divine commission to the layman and spoke to him by saying, "Arise in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and be healed." The Bible says one thing that happened in verses 11. When the people saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of Lyconia, saying, "The gods are come down to us in likeness of men." My dear one, we as men, we love worshipping what we see. That is why the Antichrist is going to bamboozle so many people. He's going to confuse many people with signs and wonders, because people love to worship what they see. If there was no the Pope,
Papa,
you'd never find a Catholic worshiping the Pope. Worshipping the church buildings, worshipping their idols, and all of that. But the Bible says, "And they called Barnabas Jupiter." They called Paul Mercurius, because he was the chief speaker. Now some of you, even there, maybe you have your chief in your village, your pastor, and some people see him as Mercurius. Maybe you have your woman pastor there, and some people see him as Jupiter. But let us see what the Bible says. In 13, Acts 14:13. Then the priests of Jupiter, which were before their city, brought oxen unto the gates, and would have done sacrifice with the people. Listen. When the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of it, they rent their clothings and ran among the people, crying out, saying, "Sirs, Why do you do these things? We also are men like of like passions. With you. And preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God, which made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all things that are in them. My dear ones, true worship belongs to our Heavenly Father, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who so loved the world and he gave his only begotten Son. We should not exchange what belongs to him to others. The Bible calls it a foreign worship, a worship that is strange. The Hebrew language calls it Avodah Zerah. That when you worship God in an unbiblical manner, that means that you are not even born again. So, my dear ones, you might say that you didn't start that idea. But I'm telling you, if you don't rebuke people like Paul and Barnabas rebuked these people from, with the truth that I know from the scripture, I doubt whether you've ever come to the knowledge of Christ, the true biblical Jesus.
Yes, my Bible.
With a lot of this ecumenism, people saying that they are the heads of born again, the head of a particular religion, those are all wrong stuff. The true church of Christ, Christ himself is the head of his church, and he does not need helpers. You can be the head of your family, but you cannot be the head of Christ's church. You can be a headmaster in some school, but you cannot be the head of Christ's church. You can be a general manager in your own business, keep it there, don't transfer to the church. Now that is very important, and we need to pay close attention to that, because remember what I said, that with the common thing today, so many churches, they commend images and they say that they do not actually worship those images, but they do venerate the faithful that they do point to. Yes, that is the idol of Mother Mary. But it's just an idol. I'm worshiping the one that it represents. That is unbiblical worship. But what we need to know is that most people are choosing to be faithful to their own churches, other than being faithful to the writing of the scriptures. They are choosing to perish, other than choosing the way of life. Scripture is very clear. Salvation is not in any other name, but in the name of Jesus Christ alone. And my dear ones, I want to reassure you about this. If you keep on adding to Christ, that is not a biblical salvation. So instead of you allowing yourself to love your church more than loving Christ and his words, we are doing this teaching to eye-open you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you might come out of that slumber. Idols are nothing. They cannot do anything for you. I'm telling you, the church from the beginning has never in one or the other, decided to endorse such practices. But just like the ancient Israelis, we are going to things that God never accepted. My dear ones, in the Bible it is very clear that idolatry is a false worship. There is no thing like, yes, we worship the spirit behind the statue. Those are not things that we find in the scripture. That is why I want to remind you again from Psalms. So the Bible adds it to say, before we go to Psalms, let me first connect this one very well. In 1 Corinthians, and we look at a verse here, chapter 10, verses 19. It says, what say I then? That the idol
ni
is anything or that
unyoni
which is offered in sacrifice to idols is something? Question mark. Verses 20. But I say that the things which the unbelievers sacrifice, they sacrifice to idols. They sacrifice to devils, not to God. And I would not that you'd have fellowship with devils. People sacrifice to devils, we are to have no fellowship with them. Because they are having fellowship with the things that are unbiblical. People who pray to idols unknowingly are praying to idols. The Bible makes it very clear in Psalms 115, beginning with verses 1. The Bible begins by saying something here that is very important. Not unto us, O Lord.
Me but one iron.
Not to us.
Me but one.
But unto your name.
And of burning.
Give we the glory.
What me tell you?
For your mercy.
Pikijani.
For your truth's sake.
Megi.
Look at verses 2.
Nenting ario.
Wherefore should the unbelievers say, where is now their God? Verse 3. The Bible has to say that our God is in heavens, and he has done whatever he has pleased. That's our God in heaven and on earth. He does what he is pleased with. But look at verses 4. To the unbelievers, their idols are silver and gold, the work of many's hands. They have mouths, but they never speak. They have eyes, but they never see. They have ears, but they never hear. They have noses, but they never smell. They have hands, but they handle not. They have feet, but they never walk. They cannot speak. They have nothing in their throat. They that make them are like unto them. And so is everyone that trusteth in them. You trust in idols, you've well defined yourself. You have eyes, but you don't see. You have a mouth, but you cannot speak. You have hands, but you cannot pick. Legs, but cannot walk. You cannot understand. You resemble what you worship. And all of those particular things, people involved in idolatry cannot hear the word of God. They instead become like the idols that cannot see or hear. But the Bible is very clear in Deuteronomy 12, verse 3. Let me also give you this one. It will make our point. It says in verse 3, and you shall overthrow their altars and break their pillars and burn their images with fire, and you shall hewn down the graven images of their gods and destroy the names of them out of place. My dear ones, God says He won't only destroy those idols, but He'll also destroy all of those that do worship them. Our relationship with God, if it is based on the pictures, then that's a sorry relationship. For the just shall live by faith. And we should boycott the traditions of men. Whatever our intention is in participating in idol worship does not matter. What matters is what God has said in His word, that we should not exalt men above that which is written. Now when you consider the book of Jonah, chapter 2 and verses 8, the Bible is very clear to show us that God has never ceased from being a jealous one. Scripture says in chapter 2, verses 8, that they that observe lying vanities forsake their mercy. Now this is it. Thank you for listening. However, what I want to say to you, if you're trusting in those lying vanities, you are not going to be disappointed, but you are already disappointed. Listen to this. The Bible says one thing that is going to last is the word of God. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but God's word will never pass away. Please, we are begging you, we are beseeching you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You love your religions, you love your traditions, but if they contradict scriptures, I'm telling you, you are forsaking your mercy. God wants to save you, but stop redefining what has already been defined. Whatever you belong to, some of you, I have seen, you are reciting those rosaries, bowing down to photos, pictures. And some of you, you still go to the graves of those so-called ministers, and you always have parties there that you are remembering, you're remembering. We only have Holy Communion that reminds us of what Jesus did for us with His body and His blood. We are not instructed to visit a particular place, even the grave of Jesus in Jerusalem. I have people going to, and some of you in your religions, you have particular places that you've designated. I hear Janani Luumu. I love you so much. Is why I'm telling you the truth. Stop being participants in those things. Do you see the Bible telling us to go to the tomb of Paul? To where Mary was buried, to where Peter was buried, to any of the saints in the Bible? These are inventions of men with the idea of straying us from that which is already written. Leave those vanities alone and believe the gospel. For the Bible is very clear. Paul the apostle apostle writing to the Corinthians, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he was very, very clear for you and I not to miss this. He says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, wherein you stand. He adds in to say, by which you are also saved, if you keep in memory of what I preached unto you, unless you believed in vain. And to some of you, holding to these things that we have debunked here, if you say you're a believer but still going back to those things, you believed in vain. Paul adds in to say, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. If you don't see the rosary is there in the scripture, the worship of idols, Aya Mother Mary, Aya Saint Joseph, Aya Saint Chizito, and all of those saints come to these born agains who are worshiping their ministers, always claiming that they received new revelations. If the scripture does not agree with new revelations, please forsake all of that nonsense. Verses 4 says that he was buried and he rose again on the third day according to scriptures. Everything should be done according to scriptures. And one thing we want to leave with you: ponder on all the things we have communicated. Look around, look through wherever you go for worship. If there are particular things, after you having taken time in the scriptures and realize that you have been doing things that do not agree with the scriptures, please do away with such things and actually go back to the gospel. Believe in the true gospel of Christ with all of your heart, trusting in his death, burial, and resurrection, and confess him as Lord. If you do that, you will do well. Don't buy time. Shalom.